Started to look at, we look into some issues that concern the believers overcoming life, and you know, some believers are affected by what they are going through, and we just want to make sure we know how to handle it. Today we're going to look at the next thing to do, and that is to pray. That is what? The special number is about pray. You know, on our Facebook account, we have the daily devotions. And you probably, who among you have read yesterday's devotion? What does the devotion say? You don't have to know everything. God will lead you. The reason why God is able to lead you, because He knows and we don't. Why is God speaking His word? So He can lead us and we can trust His leading. And all God's people say. Today we're going to look at the prayer of a righteous man. But we're not going to look at it the usual way. We're simply going to apply principles so we could do it right. In James 5:13, if you can open your Bible there. Is it open there? Okay. Now lift up your Bibles to the Lord because it's open now. This is my Bible. The Word of God. I am what my Bible says I am. I will be what my Bible says I will be. I have what my Bible says I have. And I can do what my Bible says I can do. The Word of God is powerful. Nothing is impossible with Him. I am planted in the house of my God. Praise Cathedral. I will flourish in the courts of the Lord. Even in my old age, I will stay fresh and green. As I believe, I will be. And all God's people say, who remains fresh and green? Say amen, praise God. James 5:13. Is any one of you in trouble? He should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing songs of praise. Is any one of you sick? He should call the pastors of the church to pray over him. Anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful, and the prayer of who is, and I'd like you to meditate on that. The prayer of the righteous man is and effective. There is power in the prayer of a righteous man. It's not about the unanswered prayer that really is concerns me. It's not about how many prayers that has not been answered. I think the whole problem is the prayers that has never been offered. Because I have no problem with an answered prayer because God has His reason. But prayer never been offered in faith will not bring anything to the one who has a need. For us to recognize the power of the righteous man's prayer, let us recognize first the two things that exist in our world. There are two things in our world that governs this earth. One, we call the natural world, and second, the supernatural world. The natural world is what we call, that is governed by our five senses. If you remember in your elementary, in your science, we have five senses. And what are these five senses? The sense of smell, hearing, seeing, touching, tasting. All of these gives you knowledge. You can learn by tasting, you can learn by hearing, you can learn by seeing, you can learn by smelling, and you can learn by touching. So all of these five senses gives you knowledge. Knowledge that you now know, if you use it properly, apply it to its context, we call it wisdom. You are a wise person when you use the knowledge you have to the right purpose, why you're supposed to apply those truths, the knowledge that you know. Because this is what we have in our world. The Lord used these principles of the natural world to teach us how to live our lives. These five senses are giving us what we call common sense. It teaches us not to touch what is hot. It teaches us not to smell what is bad. It teaches us to react when it is negative, respond when it is positive, or respond when it is negative. All of these five senses are teaching common sense so that we can live our lives properly. The natural world likewise is governed not only by the five senses, but what we call the principles in this world. We have laws of gravity. You know, you don't jump and then end up on the roof. When you jump on the second floor, you always land where? On the ground. You don't jump on the second floor and land on the roof. You always land on the ground. Why? Because of the law of gravity. There is the law of astronomy, how the earth and the universe are governed, how they stay where they are, and how they move. God created all of that. That is all and can be discovered and understood by science. There's a law in physics. There's a law in the birth and death. Whoever is born, the day will come that they will die. What is created will be destroyed. The laws of farming, whatever you sow, you're going to reap. You know, all of these laws that we are now living in are ways to teach us that this is how earth is governed by God. Now, for those people who haven't really understood this simple principle, I am sometimes amused that some people are expecting a harvest even if they have not planted any seed. They are not following the logic, the reason that you're supposed to use. You see, if you are going to plant, you can expect a harvest. If you give love, you're going to expect in return love. If you're giving hate, if you're sharing anger, what do you reap in return? War. Because you will always get more compared to what you have planted. All of these laws are set by God on the natural realm so that we know how to work, live, and act. Now, this is what the Bible is really teaching us, to really be using the reasons that the Lord has provided us so that we can live right. For example, I don't know why people are saying, "Pastor, I tried to open a business, but it did not work." Why will it not work? Well, probably your product is not suited for your clients. You're selling ice to Eskimos. How will it sell? You're trying to sell for adult product like blouses for elementary. It will not work. The simple reason is that you're supposed to use logic and reason on what you do. But we're not using our brain. We put up a sari-sari store, you know, in the middle of nowhere where there are no people living. Why did you put up the sari-sari store? Because this is the only space available. Yeah, you have the space, but no one will buy. So who do you think will buy from you? Your children. And we're not using our brain in making simple decisions. That's why God said, the natural world is governed by reason and logic. So when you make decisions, it should be governed by reason. nganong diniman, nganong kaniman, nganong ignaniman. If not governed and can be subjected to simple reasoning, then you must make the decision to do what is common to your sense. And when you apply it, it will be reasonable and logically giving you reason why you should continue in what you do. Now, when we understand the natural world, then we can easily project, make an expectation, lay out a future good that can possibly happen, because that's a natural work. That's a natural thing. That is how it works. When there's morning, next time is night. After night, there's morning. There's exact season God has set up in our world. So that is how it should be, and that is how God made it. Knowing that gives us a clear picture that this nature, laws, or natural world was a product of God's creation. In Colossians 1:17, God said, Colossians 1:17, He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. In Him all things what? Hebrews 1 verse 3, the Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of His being, sustaining all things by His powerful word. So what governs the natural is the word of God. Why the law of gravity is able to work? Because of the law of God. Why are we seeing what we are able to see? Because of the law of God. To give you a better picture, whatever is seen in the natural always begin with the supernatural. Whatever you see in the visible will always begin in the invisible. Now we're going to progress to the supernatural. Before you see the natural, it has and it will and will always begin in the supernatural. For example, if you want to build a house, where will you begin? In the desire, in the mind. You will go to an architect and tell the architect, I want 3 bedrooms with a maid's quarter and 4-car garage. With a room for music. And you tell the architect will draw it for you. If you like the drawings of the architect, you say, okay, let's go ahead and build it. The architect will connect with a civil engineer. The civil engineer will work out the strength of materials and start building it. And the day will come, what you started in your mind is now a reality. Why do we say there's a storm? Because there is a formation of cloud. Why do we say there is a strong wind? Because your roof is now to the other street. Very violently. Do you see the wind? You don't, but you see the fruit of what the wind does. So what begins in the natural has been started in the supernatural. And science are very able to describe how the natural exists, how the supernatural governs the natural. And because there is a supernatural, now we have to recognize this is where the realm of God works and have its being. And because this is supernatural, this is beyond our 5 senses. This is not what we would normally expect. This is not what we would say logical and reasonable, but later on, as a result and fruit of what God has done, the supernatural will begin to align and show you the reason and logic behind all of it. One thing I'd like to assure you, the Bible tells us in Romans 8:28, all things will work together for good. All things will what? Now, whatever worries you're going through right now, if you trust in God, if you would just trust in God, all things will work out for His good. All things will work out for His good. God is able supernaturally to put all disasters into a wonderful plan for your benefit. Since He is the supernatural being and He is our God, He is beyond the natural. He can therefore stop the natural, suspend the natural, extend the natural, change the natural, and put and do whatever the supernatural wanted to do on the natural. Why? Because He is the supernatural. He is in the extraordinary. He is not the ordinary. He is in the extraordinary activities. The Bible is replete of examples of these activities of God, one of which is we can find in Joshua, where God violated the normal laws of the astronomy and physics for the sake of Joshua. In the book of Joshua, chapter 10, verse 12 to 13, Joshua 10 said, "On the day the Lord gave the Amorites over to Israel, Joshua said to the Lord, in the presence of Israel, 'O sun, stand still over Gibeon. O moon, over the valley of Aijalon.' So the sun stood still and the moon stopped till the nation avenged itself in the enemies, as it is written in the book of Jashar. The sun stopped in the middle of the sky and delayed going down about a full day." Normally, 24 hours, we'll have a cycle, and 12 hours morning, 12 hours afternoon and evening. But the Bible said the evening stayed for 24 hours and the morning stayed for 24 hours. It did not move. Why? Because God, the supernatural being, was able to show himself faithful in the promise he made to Joshua. It happened likewise to Isaiah in 2 Kings chapter 20, verse 11. 2 Kings 20, verse 11. "Then the prophet Isaiah called upon the Lord, and the Lord made a shadow go back the 10 steps it had gone down on the stairway of Ahaz." Who among you were watching your shadow, and then when you were walking, your shadow didn't follow you? Pag-ingon sa imong kamot, ang shadow supposed to do the same way, but your shadow went to the other side. Like Dolphy, when Dolphy was saying on a cave, "Hello!" The cave said, "Hello, hello, hello, hello." Dolphy said, "Is there anybody here, 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 here?" And he said, "Oh, this is nice." He said, "Ang pogi ko! Ko, ko, ko." But the echo said, "Sinungaling, ngaling, ngaling." Can you imagine if that happens? Your shadow wasn't following you. Your echo was not obeying you but saying the other thing. That is not natural. That is supernatural. And what happened to the case of Isaiah, the shadow moved back 10 steps. You were just standing and your shadow said, "10. And you, "Huh?" You probably are the first person to run. And your shadow will say, "Wait, wait for me." And that would not be a natural experience. That to prove the word of God able to do the supernatural. It happened to Mary, the mother, physical birth of Jesus, who gave birth to Jesus as a virgin. How can a virgin give birth? Either she's not telling the truth, or she's just lying to tell that she's pregnant with no father. But that was the case. Luke 1:34. "How will this be?" Mary asked. Luke 1:34. Mary asked the angel, "Since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Supernatural. A young person would say, "I'm pregnant. Who's the father? I don't know." What? "I don't know the Father." Why would you not know the Father? "It was the Holy Spirit who hovered over me." Ah, okay. The father of your child inside your womb, the name is Holy Espiritu. But you cannot say that naturally it just is going to happen without one fathering the child. So the supernatural world can operate outside the laws of the natural. The supernatural can suspend, extend, stop whatever the natural is able to do. For example, the ozone layer. What do we know about the ozone layer that's now being destroyed? The ozone layer destroyed because of what? Pollution. And what is the what were the product of these? What were the causes of pollution that destroys the ozone? The manufacturing firm that is not, you know, watching on what they're emitting on their factories. As a result, we have now the global warming, which makes the cold hot and the hot cold. normally our engineers would compute the number and the volume of water per rain, and they would respond, plan based on the number of waterfall, and predict and prepare for the number of waterfall. Now, because of global warming, all of their prediction has just gone astray. Their dikes cannot hold onto it because of too much water, and their pool is not able to hold on water because of too much water. Why is this going on? Because of the global warming. They are saying now that the blocks of ice were in the North Pole is supposedly frozen for millions of years, are now turning into water. In return, it's affecting the volume of water that is being absorbed by the cloud, and as a result of it, it's being poured down to the islands or to the nations of the world. As a result, you would not stop seeing flooding every part of the world because of global warming. Now they're reacting, they're trying to change it, they're trying to correct it, but the damage is already done. Of course, it's always better to do something so that it would not create more problem. Now, we say this because we understand that the natural law, when violated, will give you wrong things. The natural law, when it is violated, will bring you hurt and harm. But when you go to the supernatural being of God to work on the natural, then you will find that the supernatural is able to correct what is in the natural. For example, in the case of Peter, where they were put in jail in Acts chapter 5. But during the night, an angel of the Lord opened the doors of the jail and brought them out. The supernatural world was able to enter the natural world and do what needed to be done. An angel came in, opened the door of the jail, and all of the believers were removed out. The disciples of Christ. It also happened in the rolling of the stone of the tomb of Jesus. In the book of Matthew 28 verse 2, there was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and going to the tomb and rolled back the stone and sat on it. Supernaturals. These are all documented, proven facts that the Bible said took place. Now, when we realize that the natural can be easily governed by the supernatural, then we understand the role of prayer, where the righteous person prays, and the Bible said the prayers of the righteous is powerful and effective. Now, your ability to see change in your life can happen, not because of your own skill or innate power, but because of the Holy Spirit, led by the word of God, telling you how things can be done. The Bible said the prayers of the righteous man is powerful, and now things can change. Now the supernatural can govern the natural. So what we now need to do is recognize our potential in changing our world. How the Lord made a promise of the prayers of the righteous. The prayer of who? Not just anyone else, but specifically the Bible described the powerful and effective prayer comes from a righteous man. And how do we know, Pastor, that I am a righteous man? Remember this. When Jesus died on the cross, he paid for the penalty of our sins. By his grace, we have been saved. You are not made righteous by what you have done. You and I are made righteous by what Christ has done on the cross. In him we live and have our being. By his power, by his grace and mercy, we are able to receive the righteousness of God. Not because we're good, but because of Christ's crucifixion on the cross, that we have accepted him to be Lord and Savior of our lives. And that changes the whole picture, because that's what the Bible said. Since you are now, the Bible calls you a righteous son of God, because you now have the right being, because of the right living, resulting to the right being as a fruit of your relationship with God, now you can really see something for real in your prayers. But before we go into that, let me remind you that what happens in the natural is a product of things that we have done. Remember, the natural lives on a cycle. When you violate something, it changes and affects the person who violates it. For example, Who among you tried for the first time? First time, people remember with me. First time you tasted the siling labuyo, or the little chili red thing that we have in our country. And you just tasted it and that. What happened to your face and to your life? You are going to be like fire. There's one missionary who came to me and said, you know, pastor, after coming to us, he said, let's eat in a hot place where there's chili. He said, I have tasted all the hottest stuff that the world can offer. And nothing beats the hot stuff of Mexico. I said, oh, I haven't never been to Mexico. I don't know what hot stuff they have. We only have here little things. He said, what do you have here? We call it siling labuyo. Salang labaya. Okay. Yeah, siling labuyo. Okay. At least it has some spike and strike on it. Yeah, I think so. Compared probably to your Mexico thing. So akong giinan tong restaurant, dahil hatagi ko ka ng siling labuyo, ka ng pinakapuwa, niya, pislitag pag-ayo ba ka ng mapino gudya. Unya, butang siya unom, kapuwa pag yun, nga wao na pusa. So naanay pusa daan, pusaon pa niya ang unom. So ako siya ginan nga, I have a little bit here already, in a small one, kanang saucer. Unya, gibutang tong napusa na nga siling labuyo. Unya, gibutang at pag unom, nga puwak ayo. Kung ka na mga isog, judaya, tanaw niya ang sili. Is this it? Sorry, you know, our size proves the chili is the same. We're not tall, we're not big, but this is what we have. Okay, this will work. At least it has some bite, right? Yeah, it has some bite. I said, oh, what you can do, after putting your chili, a little thing there, put it on your spoon, bite the red one, so at least it will add some more hot stuff, so it will give you enough what you like. He said, okay. He put on the spoon, dip on the sauce, and he got the other one, got his meat, said, oh, I'm excited. I really hope this would really make my diet very good. So he put the whole tablespoon. And I said, what happened? This is hot. This is hot. Ako siyang ginan. You see? What you sow, you reap. When we try to challenge the things of God, we will be shocked that we cannot accommodate what God can do. Don't challenge God. It will be hotter than the real siling labuyo. So what happens? There are troubles in our lives caused by disobedience. It happens not because the devil. The trouble in your life is not because of the demon. Oh, the devil made me do it. No, it's a product of your disobedience. Say to the person beside you, disobedience brings trouble. What happened to the nation of Israel with Pharaoh? Pharaoh was the culprit of the whole difficulty of the nation of Israel. So God said, Moses, tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Pharaoh said, no. I said, okay, if you don't want, then plague will come. Plague after plague after plague, and then Pharaoh would change his mind and decide to leave and then change again, not to let them go. And then, as a result of his undecisiveness in obeying God, he disobeyed God right before Moses. Hearing, seeing what God can do, he just hardened his heart. And as a result, plague hurt his whole nation. In Exodus 8, verse 8, Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron and said, pray to the Lord to take the frogs away from me and my people, and I will let your people go offer sacrifices to the Lord. For many of us, we don't understand this. But see, the frogs there were all over. Wherever you go, there were frogs. When you go to your room, there are frogs. When you go to the kitchen, there are frogs leaping on your casserola. When you go to the bathroom, there are frogs on the throne. Wherever you go, there were frogs, and they were just so much affected by it. So Pharaoh said, please pray to your God to take the frogs away. Moses said to Pharaoh, I leave you the honor of setting the time for me to pray for you and your officials and your people, that you and your houses may rid of the frogs, except for those that remain in the Nile. Exodus 8:28, then Pharaoh said, I will let you go to offer sacrifices to the Lord your God in the desert. You must not go very far. Now pray for me. Again, after Moses and Aaron left Pharaoh, Moses cried out to the Lord about the frogs he had brought on Pharaoh. And the Lord did what Moses asked. The frogs died in the houses, in the courtyards, and in the fields. They were piled into heaps, and the land reeked of them. Verse 30 to 31, then Moses left Pharaoh and prayed to the Lord. The Lord did what Moses asked. The flies left Pharaoh and his officials and his people. Not a fly remained. 9:28 of Exodus 9:28. Pray to the Lord, for we have had enough thunder and hail. I will let you go. You don't have to stay any longer. Exodus 9:33. Then Moses left Pharaoh and went out of the city, spread out his hand toward the Lord. The thunder and hail stopped. The rain no longer poured down on the land. So plagues after plagues were coming to the nation of Egypt, and the Pharaoh's heart was so hard. And as a result, he was disobeying God, and trouble were affecting the whole nation, and people were dying. And Pharaoh's heart was just so hard-hearted that he chose not to listen to God. And all the more he make his heart harder against God, all the more trouble come upon his nation. After the suffering is removed, he goes back to his old style. After the next plague is removed, he goes back to his hard heart position. And all the more he stayed with this act of disobedience, all the more his people were suffering. The good question is, when will you listen to God? When will you give up what you're supposed to give up and really listen and follow his voice upon your life? Because the more you have a hard heart against God, the more you're going to suffer. That's just a fact of life. And you need to listen to the voice of God. God intended that you hear his word, so no more katalagman, no more plague can occur over your life. Do what God says. Why do you have to fight against God when there's no reason to fight him with? And there's no logical explanation that you can do what you really think you can do. Second, there are trouble caused by sin. Our position of experiencing trouble is not a product. If it is not a product of disobedience, it's a direct going against God. 1 Samuel 12:19 said, the people all said to Samuel, pray to the Lord your God for your servants that we will not die, for we have added to all our other sins the evil of asking for a king. They were not minding the will of God. God says, you don't need a king. What you need is me. A theocratic form of government, not having a king to rule over you. But the people said, no, we want a king like other nations. We don't want a God that we cannot see. We want a real king. As a result, they got hurt. When you don't mind the will of God for your life, you go through a process, hoping that you will learn and hear the message of God loud and clear. It's the will of God that will make your life peaceful. It's the will of God that will make your life at ease and productive. 1 Kings 8:35, when the heavens are shut up and there is no rain, because your people have sinned against you, and when they pray toward this place and confess your name and turn from their sin, because you have afflicted them. The result of sin will always bring about a torture in the soul of an individual. In the case of the nation of Israel, when they were sinning against God, the Lord did not pour any rain on their land. So they were dying of starvation. They were dying for not having to have food to eat. Famine was all over because they were sinning against God, and they know it. Another example is we found in the book of Matthew 26:41. Matthew 26:41 said, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is So one, we said trouble can come because of disobedience. Second, trouble can come because of sin. Thirdly, it's because there were just no prayers made and offered unto God. God said to the disciples, watch and pray. They all fall asleep. God said, watch and pray. They all fall asleep. As a result, they cave in to their weakness, and the result was the fulfillment of what has been prophesied. And that was used, their weakness ushered in what was already predicted. Thirdly, when it comes to sickness, some of our sickness are what we call psychosomatic. Not based on virus, not based on bacteria, but because of psychological torture or psychological pressure. You call it depression, you call it aggression in your soul, and you would end up torn apart in the inside, and you don't have peace. And that happens because of issues in your soul. We talked about worries, part of which is a product of psychosomatic sicknesses, is ulcer. If you have ulcer, many of which, yes, there are physical reasons to it, but there are more reasons why ulcer is bringing in so much negative result to the body. It's more on worries and things that you keep on thinking that affects, and your body is reacting to what you think. But in the issue of sin, there are sin that is really a product of sickness, a product of sin. That's why the Bible said that your trouble in the form of sickness is a result of not listening to God. And the only way that can be stopped is not taking medical, but asking God to come and heal you. The Bible said in James chapter 5:14, is any one of you sick? He should call the pastors of the church to pray over him and anoint him with the oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. Not the medicine, but will make the sick person well. And the prayer offered in faith will make the person well. And the Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, that sin will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 30. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. The Bible said that there are even people who died because of their sickness and could have been addressed, but because they did not come and sought the face of God, they lost the opportunity to be healed. So that God said, you know, God is available. He is 24/7 available for us. And how does God come to a person? Through his children. How does God answer their prayer? Through his children. How does God show his love? Through his children. How does God provide for his people? Through his children. We are the body of Christ. We are the one that manifests the presence of God and reveal what God is able to do. You are God's hand. You are God's body. And God uses us to bring what we need to do for the life of others that need to glorify God. That's why the prayers offered in faith by a righteous man is powerful and effective. Remember, the Bible said, the prayer of who? And how do we become righteous? By accepting Jesus Christ in our hearts as Lord and Savior. We are saved by grace, not on our own work or ability. In the book of 1 John 5:14, we are the answer to the prayers of those who needed God. We are God's instrument to bring about the word of God in reality. In saying that does not mean you have to have a big head. It simply says you ought to be a servant of God, fulfilling the purpose of your existence. 1 John 5:14 said, this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, what will God do? He hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we ask of him. So when we ask the Lord and we know God hears us, What does God promise? We know that we have what we have asked of Him. So God will hear the prayers of the righteous. Say to the person beside you, you have a powerful opportunity to show God, to show God's faithfulness in my life. In 2 Corinthians 7:14, God said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. Daniel 9:23, as soon as you began to pray, an answer was given, which I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed. Therefore, consider the message and understand the vision. Your prayer is very important. Well, Pastor, I prayed, but I have not seen an answer. The answer will not come from you. It's going to come from God. Your job is to pray. God's job is to show His will. Amen? It's not about every time you pray, you would see the answer. No, it's God who will answer. Your job, my job, is to intercede. Lord, I pray that the business will become fruitful. And it did not. Wait, kalang. God is not yet done. He has His timing. You trust in God. He will show Himself. But you don't stop praying just because one prayer you did wasn't answered. That's not the attitude of a believer. Our job, trusting in God, will pray for those who have a need. Listen, you righteous man. 1 Peter 4 verse 7 said, the end of all things is near. Therefore be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. Be clear-minded, self-controlled, so that you can. 1 Peter 4:7. Proverbs 11:8. Proverbs 11:8. The righteous man is rescued from trouble. It comes to the wicked instead. Proverbs 11:19. But he who pursues evil goes to his death. Proverbs 20:7. The righteous man leads a blameless life. Blessed are his children after him. Proverbs 24:16. For though a righteous man falls seven times, he rises up again. But the wicked are brought down by calamity. James 5:16. Therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. Hebrews 11:4. By faith, Abel offered a better sacrifice than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as a righteous man when God spoke well of his offerings. By faith, he still speaks even though he is dead. There are so many scriptures about what the righteous man can do. We're supposed to learn how to. We're intercessors. As believers, we are intercessors. We are going to pray. This coming Saturday is our monthly prayer meeting. Many of you haven't been to that prayer meeting. You should exercise your given anointing to pray. Given promise of God that your prayer is powerful and effective. And the more you use it, the more you will find God can use you in a supernatural way. This morning, we're going to pray and spend 15 minutes in prayer. But the way we're going to do this, we'll divide it in three ways. One, we're going to pray for our love for God to grow. First prayer request is what? How do you know your love for God is growing? By how your life is lived. How would you know that you are pleasing to God? By how your life is lived. Second, we're going to pray that we will grow in our love for our country. Grow in what? It is so sad. The Philippines do not love their country. Sad to hear, sad to see, we don't love this country the way we should. 1997-98, when the economic crisis hit us, I saw on television how South Korea responded to the call of their president. When their country was being affected and they do not have enough, reserve to fight the manipulator of the currencies, the president said and made an announcement to the citizens of South Korea. He said, we need your help. Let us help our country to fight this economic crisis. And then they showed I think it was done by town or by cities. I have really don't know because I haven't been there. And people of Korea were bringing their golds to their officials. And it was televised. They're saying, use this for our country. I give my gold for this country so that this can be turned into reserve for our country. And Korea was able to just ward off the economic crisis because the nation of the country put themselves together to help their country fight against the economic manipulators. But here in the Philippines, when economic crisis was hitting, they were all thinking, okay, where can I go? Hong Kong, Malaysia, Singapore. We go to Europe. We have Germany, Netherlands, or Neverland. You fly in Neverland. Or you go to America, you go to the West, you go to the East, you know. You try to look for ways to escape the Philippines. Hey, this is our country. No one will love this country but us. Hello. Now, if God tells you to go to Europe, I have no problem with that. If God tells you to go to the States, no problem, go. But if the dollar was the one calling you, stay. If God never spoke the word to you to go elsewhere, don't. If you really want to go abroad and make a difference, go to Syria. Where there's civil war. Go to Afghanistan. Make a difference. Be an arm to their canyon. If you want to make a difference. But if you're only thinking of yourself, please start here. If you think our country is bad and there is no future in this country, why would Schumart keep building their MOAs? And they're building it in our South Road properties. If you think this country is poor and no future, why is Robinson building their new mall in the Pier area? And why are the condominiums are building here and there? There's no money in the country. That's why they're building it. Huh? Now, let me tell you this. If you really are sure that this country is doomed, no future, I'd like you to convince Henry C. Set an appointment with the owner of Schumart and tell him, don't invest in this country because this country has no future. Convince him. Tell him. You have a doctorate degree of criticism. You have a doctorate degree of not trusting on anyone. Tell Henry C. Don't build anymore, Henry C. Your investment will go down the drain. Tell him, if you are really true that this country is doomed and there's no future in our country. Hey, you're living in Cebu City, the Queen City of the South, the center of the universe. Hello. Let's give God a hand of praise. This is the best land you could ever live. Not Manila, not Bacolod, not Davao. They said, it's Cagayan de Oro. Yeah, you have bombings just yesterday. We need to pray for our country. This is Cebu. This is where we live. This is our land. We're not going to be an opposition to anybody. We're going to be a cohesive force. We're going to be an instrument where this country will be strong again in Jesus' name. You know, I was shocked. Just realized this. The one that goes to television and carry the red flags, whoever be the president, they're always going against it. Bisag kinsa presidente, ibagsak, ibagsak. Wala gi presidente, wala nilang gigikalipay. Kung kinsa mo giilang gusto eh. Gipabagsak to, gigipulian, kanako no. After several months, lahi na po. Kung sa may gusto ng mga tawana, do they really love this country or they just want to take, you know, the ratings on the television so that they will have continuous funding? Let's love this country. We need to pray that each one of us will love this country. And how can you show that? Work right. Live right. Don't throw your garbage anywhere. Ayaw pangi, bisagasang bumbong na ay makita. Amen? Wait out. Unless di na gid nimo mapugan, mabuto na imong kidney. Nya kundakpon ka nga nung nangika, sir, magpadakop na lang siya, diingid mada kayo mo. Basa may na akong karsunis, kundi na ako paghauso ng akong gibati. Love this country. Amen. Don't steal from the government. Why would I not steal from the government? They're stealing it themselves. That's their problem, not yours. Yours is to support the country. In Jesus' name. Let's pray for this love to grow in us. And that's what we need. That's what we lack. Loving this country. Instead of looking for other countries, ulamiya dito mo po yung hangin, prisko, butang tayo sa Facebook, nga naakos likod, aning... Hey, this is still the best place. I would like you to go around the world, have a tour. But you love this country. You live in this country. This is the best place. You know why? Because God gave you birth here. Kung may planong ginuon mo diri, dili kaniya ipakatao diri. Kung gusto kaniya sa Amerika, dito unta ka na tao, igsuon din ka na tao. Ang mga ilong, muginhawa. And that is best. Amen. Let's pray that our love for our country will grow in Jesus' name. Ina imuntapad, please, change. Amen? Don't change address. New York na. No. New York, Cubao, Quezon City, okay rin na. But last and thirdly, we're going to pray for our neighbors. How do we do that? We'll do it later. I'd like the worship team to come. We'll just all stand up, please. We're going to sing a song to the Lord, worship Him, open, prepare our hearts, and then we will go into prayer. Let's sing the song, Lord, I give you my heart. This is my desire. Thank you, Lord. We give you honor and praise. For the Lord's presence to govern us and our love for Him to grow. Father, right now we lift up to You each other. We know, God, that You are the Lord of our lives and You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. And Lord, we pray that each individual that are here present will rise up in their love for You. They will not be cold. They will not just be warm, but they will be hot, oh God, as cold, really giving the burn of their love for You. Lord, we pray that there would not be a Christian in this house that is not fully committed to the Lord, but they will grow and they will see their love for You growing day by day, and they will manifest their growth and maturity as they love You and serve You. Father, we thank You, God, for Your love will never die on us. Your love for us remains, and that is why we can easily love You in return. And we pray, God, for every individual individual, every Christian, every person present in this room, let your love, your compassion, your passion within them, God, grow in Jesus' name. They would love your word. They would love your services. They would love your Bible studies. They would love you more and more. And Lord, they will enjoy serving you by serving your people. They would love, oh God, you more and more day by day, by what they do, by how they speak, how they say things, whatever they're doing, God, you will continue to proclaim your goodness upon them. Holy Spirit, come, come, and let the growth of every believer's, Lord, continue to happen in this house. This house is a place for mature people, for people who love God, for people who have given themselves to the Lordship of Jesus, and all of us will continue to enjoy, oh God, your presence. And Lord, we're going to be an example for others to see, because your presence will manifest in our midst, and our love for you will grow each day, each moment, each opportunity, for you are the God of our lives, and we need you in us, Holy Spirit. Oh, thank you, Lord, for each heart, each soul will continue to grow in the knowledge of God, and in the word of God, and in the commitment they have with you. Now, everyone across the aisle, hold each other's hand. We're going to pray for our country. Let's unite together. Let's believe God for the best in this land. Let's fight the battle of physical war into a spiritual battle and bring peace on our country. Father, today we declare, this is the land of the Lord. This is the land of God. Lord, there will be a stoppage to war. There will no longer be war in our country. That will stop in Jesus' name. And there will be lasting peace in our land. Lord, investors will now come in. Oh God, investors will now trust our land. And Lord, war will now cease. War will not continue. In Mindanao, in Basilan, no more kidnapping, Lord God. All of this criminality will stop in Jesus' name. All of these corrupt officials will stop in Jesus' name. They will be exposed, oh God. They will be exposed in Jesus' name. And they can no longer take advantage of our country. They can no longer take advantage of their position in the government. God, you will expose them. Expose them, Lord God. So they will stop and they will have a fear of God. For you are true to your word. You are God over our country. We speak for our government officials, from the president down to the barangay officials, Lord God. Let them rule and govern by the righteousness of Christ. Let them rule and govern by justice, by the truth of your word, and by the influence of your believers. Lord, I pray for good governance. I pray for good influence for all consultants, oh God, to have a fear of God. To those who are in office in our government, we speak life of Christ in them. And Lord, for the private sector, for the non-government offices, in the name of Jesus, we pray that they'll be united in serving you in this country. Lord God, there will be a stoppage to the sinful things that they do, to the corruption that they do. But God, your rule will reign and your presence will be made known. Our country will be known as a genuine Christian nation in all of Asia, and we will continue to send missionaries all over the world and to prepare the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Father, we speak life to our coffers. We speak life to our government in the name of Jesus. Lord, there will be no more poverty in our country. Lord, give them wisdom. Give them, Lord, a heart to study. Give them heart to work, all of our poor brothers and sisters. Let them know your will for their lives. Let them not depend on the government, but let them find themselves as another solution to the problem. Lord, let the poverty be stopped. Provide them means, right wisdom, right knowledge. Lord, whatever the plans of the government to help them alleviate and taken out of poverty shall happen, it will be done. For you are our God. We speak more investment in this country, more people to invest in our nation, more opportunities, job openings, more manufacturing firms, more trust upon other nations. Give us favor, O God, as the nation will know us, the country that loves God and honors God, and our lives will reveal the truth of God. For you are our Lord, you are our God. In Jesus' name. And one more, I'd like you to go to a person you do not know, and I mean you do not know, because we would like to pray the love for our neighbor that you haven't really known So look for person. If your husband and wife, look for somebody else. If you are with a person that your friend, music team, join us. Person you don't know, because loving your neighbor is really a strange thing. It's praying, loving, caring for somebody you do not know. That's what a neighbor is. So please go to people you are not familiar. And that is the reason why we're doing this. You want to kind of exercise this opportunity of praying. Look around you. If you're praying for your brother or your sister or your parent, please look for somebody else. Pastors, can they help us? Connect group leaders, let's make sure we are able to exercise what it is to pray for our neighbor. Neighbor is not somebody you are familiar. Neighbor is someone you don't know, so that you can begin praying for each other. Get to know one another, you know, get their details so that you would be able to pray for that person. Ask them, what do they want God to do for their lives? What's their dream? And pray for each other. The first person will pray and agree the other, and the other one, after the other person prays, then you will be the one to pray as well. Now begin. Let's pray. Show your mercy right now. Reveal your grace to your people. Let the healing flow right now. Let the answer to the prayers be revealed right now. Holy God, you are powerful. Nothing is impossible with you. God, bring your presence. Thank you, Lord, for the answers. Thank you, Lord, for our lives that you have given us. Answers to all our prayers, God. Thank you for the prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Thank you for our righteousness comes from the righteousness of Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you. answers to all our prayers. We know that your word will not return to you empty. It shall not return to you void. Thank you, Lord, for hearing us this morning. We honor and give you praise in Jesus' name. Let's give God a wonderful hand of praise. Father, we give you honor. We give you all the glory.